How good ideas are transformed into good opportunities is not straightforward. The company Nowi clearly explains their offer.
At Nowi, we're developing sensors that last forever. And the way we're doing that is quite unique. So we're using Wi-Fi, 4G, and GSM signals as a power source. So we can actually get a little bit of energy from the Wi-Fi and 4G signals that are all around us and use that to power the sensors. So what happens right now, if you make a climate sensor, for example, there will be a battery in there or either a cable to handle the power supply part. The problem of that is if you put a battery in there, you have to do maintenance very often. So that doesn't really work if you're putting 10,000 sensors in a new office building, for example, or any type of really Internet of Things solution. It's not feasible. So what we're doing is by using these signals, so we don't have to do maintenance anymore, and we can create what we call a plug and forget sensor, so a sensor that simply works forever. So if you look at a new office building, for example, you'll easily need several thousand sensors. Whereas a few years ago, you would simply only put a smoke detector in there, for example. So what happens if you have such a high scale of sensors? This is where the lifetime becomes an issue. So if I have to change the battery in a smoke detector once a year, it's not really a problem. But if I have to do this 5,000 times every year, it becomes a problem. So we see this in buildings, but we also see it outdoors.
While this seems so logical, the path to it isn't always that easy.
So what we're doing today is not necessarily how we started, so there have been some pivots along the way. So if you look at Internet of Things, the massive, massive scale of connected devices creates an energy supply problem. So I think McKinsey says there are going to be 60 billion connected devices in 2025, Intel says 200 billion, whatever it ends up being, it's an enormous, enormous amount of these devices. And we saw from a lot of sort of early projects that they were not really fulfilling their promise, because if you can save 10% on energy costs in a building by having more temperature sensors, the business case doesn't work if I have to send somebody there every 6 months to change the batteries in that sensor. Then the cost of doing that are actually higher than my savings would be, and people are not doing it. So that's kind of where we recognize the need. There is a problem, right? And that creates a need, I would say. But at the same time, at TU Delft, there's been a good 10 or 15 years of academic research on wireless power transfer and energy harvesting methods. So there's this interplay. It wasn't necessarily obvious from the start that this would be the solution. So we were learning what was going on in the research lab at electrical engineering, for example, and that influenced our ideas on how to solve that problem. It's a very basic idea saying, well, there's an enormous amount of connected devices. There's something of an energy supply problem, but that doesn't really give you a market proposition yet or a value proposition. So we talked to a lot of companies in different fields, in different industries, and that gave us more of a scope on where is the problem the biggest, where are people actually willing to pay for the solution as well, where is it really a need-to-have solution instead of a nice-to-have solution, and there was a lot of market research in that, and it's still ongoing. We're kind of doing that continuously, having this market feedback loop, and that's always changing the product.
The example of Nowi shows that identifying the fit between your offer and the customer may require several pivots. Also, connecting your offer to existing services and products is important for identifying the exact value of your offer. BitSensor shows how they found a way to make their hacking alarm compatible with existing platforms.
So there is a technology for detecting hackers. It's only not effective. It generates too many alerts. And it also doesn't generate alerts when there is actually an attack. So there were like two problems. And we needed to solve both problems in order to like build a technology that actually works. And so we were thinking about then building a technology that could solve those two problems by building an application security tool that doesn't work in the network, but works inside the application itself and see how the application itself is attacked. And so we worked on that, and we saw it was hugely, hugely effective. And so there was the technology that when we said, hey, now makes sense to build a company around this technology. But there was like several like important things to test first, because first of all, nobody thought like people would install a plugin into their application to do security. Everybody thought it should be on the network. So we needed to validate that first. And then we did it as a SaaS service in the cloud. And as well, nobody thought we wanted security as a cloud solution. Everybody thought it needed to be on premise. And so we proved that second point as well. And this was needed to build, like to solve the problem in a scalable way.
Besides the technology, Wim van Hoeve from Tide Microfluidics explains that a deeper understanding of your customer and the people involved is key as well.
How we met that was by really talking to people in the field. So when we had our first products, we really went out to talk and see to get the customer's feedback. And very interesting thing was in the beginning when we had our first prototype, we went out, we invited cardiologists, veterinarian researchers, and we gave a live action demonstration with our first prototype, and we could see the enthusiasm of these people, and we could learn a lot. They could see what we were developing, and we could learn how they could use our products in their clinical practice. So that gave us a lot of information, and that helped us to further develop this product.
Henk from Snowcomb explains that it is exactly this customer feedback that you need to identify the right market segment.
I started in the airport market. So when I made this sketch of a machine that could just take up all the snow from one runway, I thought, okay, I've made now this sketch. I think it's a good idea, but the market should confirm if the idea is good, yes or no. So I approached Amsterdam Airport Schiphol and I asked them, how do you feel about this sketch and would this help you? And they said, well, never heard of snow compression before. So that's interesting. But did you consider of how about getting this machine on and off the runway? How do you see some guys steering this machine and all these practical challenges that airports face in order to make this machine work, yes or no? So I started with the airport market. And I was offered a master thesis spot at the airport. So my current focus is still airport market. When I came up with a potential solution, they said, well, never heard of this before, never thought of it before. This could work. And then the original idea, the original sketch I made for the runways, basically changed due to the feedback of the airports to a solution not for the runways, but for the aprons, so at the gate where as a passenger you get in and out. So the product also changed over time.